Hello and welcome back to the Modern Data Lake on MinIO series. In this session, we're going to be covering in-place table evolution, and we're going to be talking about how to modify things like schemas, partitions, and even contents of the data within a partition. All this is going to be done in a zero-copy way, which means it's going to be highly performant, and it's going to scale even to large and very complex tables. Definitions. Let's kind of level set on some of those. We, of course, have schemas, and we also have partitions. Schemas are the logical structure of the table. So that's going to be things like columns, names, data types, as well as their respective relationships, both primary and foreign key. The ability to define schemas, that's a pretty unique ability to at least more modern data lakes, because that gives us the ability to use schema on write instead of schema on read, which allows us to enforce quality controls and prevent bad data from entering our tables in the first place. Partitions, of course, are the ability to group various items and files together, and that's going to give us the ability to get some great performance gains when we're doing high volume reads and writes. Okay, let's talk a little bit about some of the principles that underlie table evolution. So evolving our tables in a modern data lake, it helps to abide by a couple of specific principles. Firstly, we want to do that in a way that is consistent. And by that we mean all of the changes should be made atomically, all or nothing, and they should be done in a way that allows our queries to always return fully consistent results and never partially correct or partially complete results. Next, we really want to be performant. And by this, we mean that at read time, we want the compute engine to come up with optimized query plans. We don't want it to read in extraneous or unnecessary objects. We don't want it to reference partitions that are unnecessary to resolve the query. And then at write time, we want to be sure that we don't require expensive rewrites every time we make small changes to our schemas or partitioning scheme. We also want everything to be inferable by the query engine. And so what we mean here is we don't want our end users, those using the data lake, and querying our tables to have to be aware of things like the physical structure of the table or specific filters they might need that are really rigid and locked into that particular query they're using that just to take advantage of the partitioning scheme. We kind of just want all of this to happen automatically for our query engine to infer the correct query plan for us. We also want everything to be scalable. Everything should be able to scale easily into the petabytes of data, and even in the exabyte scale, and we don't want to have to rethink our architectural decisions. Okay, let's go back to our data and metadata diagram that we looked at in the last session here, and let's think a little bit about how this works with an object store like MinIO. If we think about the way object stores work, we can remember that they use what's called immutable storage. What that means is that every time we want to make a change to the file, we're going to read that file in, we're going to make our change, and then we're going to persist a brand new copy of the entire file to disk. This approach, this immutable storage approach, works really well with open table formats like Iceberg because they track metadata separately from the data itself. So in practice, every time we make a change to our table state, we're really just making a new metadata file. This metadata file is going to list the updated schema, the partitions, the manifest files, whatever it is we changed. The snapshots, and recall that snapshots are just point-in-time representations of that table, those are going to be listed inside these separate manifest files, and each of those is going to point to anywhere from hundreds to even thousands, it's not uncommon in a production cluster, in a production data lake, of underlying parquet files. Okay, so zooming out a bit, what does this mean in practice? Well, it means that we can make changes to the schema or partitions literally just by swapping out metadata files, and nobody is going to see these changes if we have a multi-concurrent user environment. Nobody's going to see those changes. They're isolated until they read in that new metadata file. So that's a bit about how metadata works. Let's talk just a bit about how data itself gets updated in a modern data lake. There's generally two strategies here, one called copy on write and one called merge on read. And those are going to differ in that copy on write makes changes by rewriting the underlying objects at the time the change is made. Conversely, merge on read is going to write new files and then apply those changes at the time that the query engine reads them in. So let's look at the copy on write strategy a bit more closely. Effectively, in this case, we have a delete statement, and we're going to read in a data file from the data lake. We're going to apply the change, the delete operation, to that data file, and then we're going to write it back as a brand new object in the data lake to supersede or replace the original. This gives us a bit slower writes because we're doing a little bit more work here. We're doing all the writing at this point in time, but it allows the reads to be super fast because they have very little to do. They just read the file. This is going to be great for batch processing or just situations where updates are just somewhat infrequent and deletes are not that common. And these are, again, situations where the write time penalty, it just doesn't matter that much. We really want to get maximum read time performance. Okay, so there's another strategy called merge on read, where data changes are going to be written to new objects. And that means that every time a new change is made, we're going to create a brand new object separate from the original. We're not replacing the original object, we're creating a new object. And then we're going to merge it in at query time by the compute engine. This is going to have the inverse characteristics from the copy on write strategy. Namely, it's going to be faster at writes, but a bit slower at reads. This is going to be great for workloads where we're trying to do real-time streaming or highly transactional workloads where we have a lot of frequent updates, high volume, maybe we have a lot of deletes, and we want to make sure that we have a lightning fast performance at write time. So the idea here is you have two strategies you can use for any given table in your data lake. By applying the right one, copy on write versus merge on read, you can get the optimal performance based on the particular workload profile you have. Let's talk a bit about why in-place table evolution is so useful. So this particular capability is going to unlock a couple things. Firstly, it's going to allow us to make backwards compatible schema and partition changes. And we can do that without breaking any backwards compatibility, which means that if we want to look in the past or look at data that maybe is from a different point in time, we can do that without having to compromise our ability to adapt or evolve our schema in the future. We can also use something called hidden partitioning. And this is the ability for the query engine to easily infer what the optimal partitioning strategy is, whether it's by date, by ID, by some subset of the timestamp, for example, without having to force the user to provide that within the query in a very strict and rigid way. We can also use what's called split plan queries. And this means that even within a given query, we could literally write one query, send it off to the compute engine, and it might use multiple different query plans that use different partitioning schemes based on how and when they were created in time. And then lastly, we've got this ability to make these really fine-grained trade-offs between different workload profiles. So whether you're doing high-speed real-time writes and you want to make sure that your write time performance is great, or maybe you're doing more traditional batch-style analytics and aggregations, you're going to be able to get the optimal performance based on your needs. Great, we've now got a solid understanding of in-place table evolution. Let's go ahead and dive right into the lab. For this guided exercise on in-place table evolution, we're going to reuse the same containerized data lake environment from the last session. Check out the link below for the environment setup instructions in case you need them again. We're now going to create an iceberg table. In this case, it's called fact_orders_v2. We're adding the v2 at the end just to prevent a table name collision from our last exercise. Like we saw in the last session, this table is going to be partitioned by day. It's got an order ID, a customer ID, an order amount, and order timestamp columns. We're going to add a few custom properties. That's the write.delete mode, write.update mode, and write.merge mode. And we're going to set all of those properties to copy on write. This will tell our compute engine, in this case Dremio, that our table should use the copy on write strategy for all these operations, namely updates, merges, and deletes. Next, we're going to run this SQL statement to insert two rows into our table. Now, let's just prove that the rows were successfully added by querying the table. And sure enough, there they are. Okay, now let's show how schema evolution actually works. We're now going to run this query against an iceberg metadata table. And it's going to show us metadata about all the iceberg data files that are being used in our data lake. Note how there's only one single data file shown with a record count of 2. This makes sense since we inserted two rows in our table just a moment ago. Now let's have a look at the create timestamp of this data file back in our terminal using the mcls command. Note that when we run this command, the timestamp shown indicates the last time this particular object was updated in our object store or data lake. We're going to refer back to this in a moment just to prove that the file did not change, even though we updated the schema. Okay, now let's modify the schema. Suppose that our business has evolved and we're now doing business in multiple countries. We've decided we need to add a currency column and we need it to keep track of the local currency for each order in the table. To do this, we're simply going to run this table statement right here. Okay, now let's go back to our terminal and let's rerun our command to view the timestamp of that same data file, that same parquet file, belonging to the table with the schema that we just altered. Sure enough, the timestamp is unchanged. This shows us that we can change our schema without rewriting a single object in our table. Whether we have 1,000, 1,000,000, or even 1,000,000,000 rows on the table, a schema change is going to happen instantly. Iceberg also maintains references to our old schema for historical reporting on old data in case it's needed in the future. That's schema evolution. Now let's move on to partition evolution. Suppose that our business is booming and we're seeing a huge surge in order volume. We're getting complaints that queries are slowing down, and to solve that, we want a finer grained partitioning scheme. Recall that earlier when we initially created the table, we used a daily partitioning scheme. By executing this SQL here, we're going to alter our schema, and we're going to add an hourly partitioning scheme as well. This means data files will now be smaller, because they'll be grouped both by day as well as by hour, which should improve performance. Again, note how executing that command was instantaneous. This would perform well even on a huge table, because we're just writing tiny metadata files. Okay, now let's execute this SQL here, and that's going to simulate two new orders that are being ETL'd into our data lake. Remember, these new rows are from after the hourly partitioning scheme was added. Now let's take a look at the files iceberg meta table again. Notice that we're now showing three rows, and that corresponds to three files. The original file on row 3 has a daily partitioning scheme and a row count of 2 for the original two rows that were added. The more recent files on rows 1 and 2 have both a daily and hourly partitioning scheme and a row count of 1 each respectively for the two rows we inserted, each of which was from a different hour on the same day. It's particularly interesting to note that Iceberg-compatible compute engines like Dremio can even split query plans within the same query. This means that a single query might get broken down into multiple different query plans that are optimal for each partition that need to be scanned by the query engine. Moreover, unlike queries from the Hive and Hadoop era, we don't even need to specify which part of the timestamp the query engine should use. Whether it's by day, hour, minute, that's all just figured out or inferred automatically for us by the query planner. This is what we call hidden partitioning. That's partition evolution. Let's move on to our final part of the lab, and that's going to show us how copy on write works. Note from the previous query how we have exactly three data files in our data lake. Now, let's run this query here, and that's going to pull up the four rows in our table which belong to these three partitioned data files. Now, let's explicitly delete the row with order ID 112. Remember, that's the one from the original partition file, and that one is using only a daily partitioning scheme. Now, let's go back to the files iceberg metadata table and look at the underlying data files. Sure enough, even though we deleted a row, our current snapshot still has precisely the same number of parquet files, namely 3. Remember that when we created our table, we explicitly set our delete strategy to copy on write, not merge on read. This means that even when we delete a row, we still have the same number of complete data files when the operation is completed. This is different from the merge on read strategy, which if we were using, would have added a fourth deletion file. The query engine would then have become responsible for merging that deletion file back in at query time, which would make reads a bit slower and writes a bit faster. Here, the copy on write strategy, it's just going to rewrite the entire original file, but omitting the row that was deleted. And there you have it, folks, in place table evolution on a modern data lake. We covered schema evolution, partition evolution, and the difference between copy on write versus merge on read. Keep your environment fired up and follow me along into our next session. See you there.